What is up, everybody? Thank you for joining me for episode 54 of Let's Nerd with Pathfinder Kingmaker, Extra Nerdy Edition. Your host, Jay Dumont. In the last episode, we discovered that the Spriggans found the town empty. We talked to a raven, so now, what to do, where to go? Try to figure out what happened with Varnholm, how they vanished. Seemingly in thin air. Something ran the Spriggans out of their cave, so we have to head probably to the Spriggan cave and see what's going on there. We might just adventure a bit. Overgrown cave. Let's head to Shallow Gulch, shall we? Come on. There we go. A small ravine in the foothills, the place can be treacherous for unwary travelers. But we are wary. While traveling through the hills of Nomen, we notice something worrisome. Crows circle the sky, much as they do upon spying a corpse to feast upon. More ominous yet, clouds of smoke trailed into the sky as well. After noticing that, we approach carefully, trying not to reveal ourselves. We soon saw what attracted the crows. A dead horse lay in the ditch, one leg missing, and its carcass already picked at by scavengers. Near the horse was what looked to be the corpse of its former rider, a young man clad only in undergarments. The smoke was coming from a bonfire around which goblins were roasting a horse leg. It seemed their hunger was stronger than their fear of these animals. Other goblins were busy rummaging through the clothes of a deceased man and taking whatever choice bits they could find. One goblin was strutting around wearing a beret with a feather, another a velvet jacket, and two other goblins, each wearing a single boot, were in the middle of a tug of war with the dead man's trousers. When we saw this, we bared our weapons and menacingly demanded an explanation. Realizing that we weren't in a playful mood, the goblins grew defensive, almost pleading. "It not us! We not killed no one! He already deaded!" The goblins' words tumbled over each other in their haste to exonerate themselves. But they seemed to be sincere. "Horse threw him, nasty thing, broke his neck. Horse killed him, we not even tried eating him." After hearing the stories, we let the goblins go with the warning, but before that we made sure to reclaim everything they'd taken from the deceased, including a hefty coin pouch. 1636, Mathienheim, thank you, letter. Alas, in this backwater, coin proved of little use. Alas, the body laid before us belonged to none other than Tomenhan Fanki, a noble from Groutland, the one whose brother begged us to look for him. Letter in his jacket pocket, yellowed with age, confirmed his identity. It was signed Matayan Hanfaki, a relative. All we could do was take the tragic news to his brother. Which we will do. Right now. Only takes a day and 10 hours. Get out of these mountains. Something happening at the kingdom. Jubilas fail. The treasurer assigned specifically changed money changers to the markets to detect the illusions. However, there were too few of them to validate every transaction of Araby. -4 to economy. Triumph. The peasants accepted the general's invitation, and they already begun trading. Our people's patriotism only grows. Awesome. Jubilas demands an audience. We'll be back in town in a jiffy. We'll go to the tavern and deliver this news. Only a day's journey, not too bad. our adventure. So let's see here.
More strength.
Alright, the brother's here. Let's see what this letter says, if there's anything useful to our needs here. Diane had Vanky's letter. Penrod, my dear brother, I hasten to share the good news. Our family's financial predicaments will be happily resolved in the near future. How, you ask? Well, by the grace of the Cyclopes, of all things. You see, these beasts who once used to inhabit Ioberia have become our benefactors. While studying ancient maps, I've discovered the location of several of their tombs in the hills of Nomen. It's common knowledge the Cyclopes used to bury their dead with their treasures, treasures they have no need of. Fortune calls, my brother. In a day soon to come, the Hanvanki's family coffers shall be full to bursting. Your brother, Duke Matthian Hanvanki. Well, I'll be the one to share the bad news, I suppose.
I'm hungry. When may starve?
Did you manage to find anything? I have bad news for you. Your brother is dead. I found this letter on his body. Is that so? My poor father won't be able to cope with such a loss. What have you done, brother, and for what? After reading the letter, Edra sighs bitterly and shakes his head in dismay. So, that's how it all started. My brother found our great-grandfather's letter in the family archives, and he decided to follow his example. And most unfortunately, he did. This means I'm the heir of the title now, but this doesn't give me the tiniest trifle of joy, believe me. Well, I'll have to stay in your capital for a while. If during your travels you happen to find yourself in this ill-fated tomb, do me a favor and tell me what the two Hanvanki daredevils died for. Tell me about your great-grandfather. Matthian Hanvanki was known for his bravery and recklessness. When our family was dealing with some financial difficulties, his best idea was to leave his family estate, his wife and his children in the care of his brother, and go off treasure hunting with a group of daredevils of the same kind, let's say. No one has seen him since. Unfortunately, stories like this aren't unusual in our family. Stories about the exploits of my great-grandfather have become legends. The bards praise his courage. Too bad no one wrote any songs about his widow and everything the poor woman had to endure. Let's see what I could do for you. Look forward to any news you may find. Discover what happened to Edra's great-grandfather. That. Like the tavern music. Wish I could hear that while traveling through my capital. Christian, everything good with you? So we'll handle some matters of state. And then head back out to the hills of Komen. Try to find the great-grandfather. What I really like about this game is the fleshed out lore, since it's based on a world that has so much richness in the pen and paper game. That really adds to the depth of lore in the game itself. You feel like this is a real place, like it's a fleshed out world, not just something someone quickly came up with during a dev cycle. Hello, Jubilost. Amazing, you managed to save your barony from an invasion of monsters from the First World, but you were not able to protect it from the attention of the First World's more powerful denizens. Believe it or not, but Ganvilla has been chosen as the next location for the inconsequent debates. I've heard about them, strange entertainments held on Galarian by Feylords from the First World, strange tests with various unique rewards. Your knowledge is, well, pleasantly surprising. It's true, the inconsequent debates are anything but debates. They say that the eldest once made a bet. No one knows what it was, but sometimes one or another of them sends a delegation of Fae to Galarian, where they hold insane competitions for those who volunteer to enter, and present the winners with whimsical awards. The contest and the reward are different every time, although every time is a stretch. Only 3 such occasions are known over thousands of years. Anyway, it's happened again, and this time the reward is a chance to ask any question whatsoever of the host, the competition's mastermind. This creature, whoever it is, speaks on behalf of the eldest. Do you see why we can't miss such a chance? You want to use this opportunity to find out why the gnomes left the first world and how they might return, right? Nice to see our association has left the mark on you. Yes, of course. I'm none too happy that we'll have to play by the eldest rules. You know my opinion of the Feylords isn't very high. But if that's what the truth requires, then so be it. In the end, who would best know the answer to my question, if not the self-appointed deities of the first world? Do you know anything about these debates, or are we completely in the dark here? You never know what mad ideas the Fae might have cooked up. I only know one condition. Only teams of 3 are allowed to participate. Who do you think we should take as our third? I think we should take Lindsay. Something tells me Fae are not likely to hold competitions in rope pulling or beer drinking, but the skills of a bard might come in handy. Besides, we should give the young lady a chance to channel some of that energy. Can participating be dangerous? Considering that the Fae are involved, absolutely. But if the chronicles are true, no one has died in any previous debate. We can't pass up such an opportunity. I agree to participate. Great, I'll mark the spot on the map where the competition will take place. The sooner we arrive there, the better. The Fae Lords won't wait forever. Aw, no new gifts? Attend the debates. Man's best friend. Some disrepute offering a litter of puppies. Craftsman submitted a complaint against a tax collector. According to the craftsman, the tax collector demanded double payment this month. The collector admitted that he'd taken some of the taxes he collected, then tried to collect the tax again to hide his crime. Jubilost. Let's take care of this. Six days for the curse of Tapic Nettle. Hunting for Morhalan ends in 4 days. Abolishing trade tariffs on imported goods from Groton will forego immediate profits, but will provide a solid foundation for stable long-term growth. +5 to economy. Pretty good. Let's do it. And off to the great inconsequential debates we go. I wish I hadn't sold some of those weapons. I'd like to have gotten a focus on the Falcata. Or at least a proficiency in the Falcata. But alas, the coffers are empty. I don't know, let's go talk to the storyteller. Again, I feel we should have had more stories for by now. It's all the same stuff. Money. Blind darkness underground, bronze blades clashing. The cold of serpent folk and the hot blood of cyclopes mingle on a stone floor. Something else, fear, desperation, agonizing shame. I cannot yet tell what happened there underground, but if you collect all of the pieces, I'll be able to tell you the story of their owner.
I'll go ahead.
Keeping that full plate in case I make Ekin become a paladin. Still thinking about doing that. Because in my previous run, he talked a lot about Torag. He worships Torag. And I think he could turn his life around and become a paladin of Torag. First, we go to the inconsequential debates.
Knock knock.
Capital rebuilt properly. Juby Lindsay. Inventory weight is too great. Gotta sell some stuff. Let's see what you have. Emeralds or the ruby? Guess it won't hurt to sell those. Can I travel with 600 pounds? Physical perfection. How about the physical protection? Increases strength. And so you can have the belt of incredible dexterity. All that strength. Oh, and Amiri has cloak, I believe. Successful bite deals additional 1d6 and trips the target. I'm gonna give that to him because he's going to be biting once he levels up. What's this? Enchantress Cape, bonus 1 to enchantment school spells DC. Jubilost has plus 5 on trickery checks. Enchantment. Crushing despair. Various potions.
Go ahead.
Can we travel? Go to our shared stash. And I'll keep the Fae waiting. Greetings, Baron. open screen. Alright, we'll stash the reading materials and stuff. I should have just stashed the 31 rations. I keep forgetting how heavy rations are. So I guess we'll take 6 rations just in case. Depending on where these inconsequential debates are. So heavy. Consequent debates. Unassuming place was chosen by one of the Fey Lords as a location for inconsequent debates. The Fey certainly know it's certainly unremarkable into the unforgettable one way or another. One day in 6 hours. Oh, we're traveling heavy. Small but well-armed group moves around with flatlands, tattoos, leather and fur clothing, bone amulets at their belt. These are barbarians, Kelids to be precise, probably from neighboring Numeria or maybe lands even further north. They stop when they see you, hands on their weapons and frowns on their faces. Who are you then? What do you want? Barbarians watch you sternly, their hands still on their weapons. One of your people seems to be sick. Can I help? We don't need your help, the Kelid starts, his voice grim, but he's interrupted when one of the barbarian women begins coughing uncontrollably. If you don't need it, just shut up so I can, the barbarian woman breaks into another short coughing fit and spits on the ground. The phlegm is blue. I'm not going to die for your pride. Yes, I'm sick. Caught blue spit somewhere in the barrens. Don't worry, I don't think it's catching. If you heal me, I can pay in gold. Neutral good, heal a barbarian. No charge. No, none of that. We're not beggars and we're not out for charity. The barbarian woman forces several coins into your hand. After you heal the woman's disease, she breathes in deeply, relishing the sensation. Wow, thank you. It was a nasty thing, let me tell you. Won't let you take breath in or let gases out. I'm Nober. We're from Numeria, part of the Tiger Lord's tribe. We're just minding our own business here, not looking to pick a fight. We don't want any trouble, we're not after anyone. What are you searching for? The Kellid frowns. No idea, really. Dugoth just said we should search for caves and ancient ruins, and he'd tell us if it was what we were looking for. You ask me, we're just wasting time out here, but Chieftain knows best. Now these are what I call good assistants, dutiful, prompt, and aware of their own intellectual limitations. Why can't I ever get assistance like that? Maybe I should have pursued a career as a barbarian chieftain. Have you found anything interesting in the area? I wish. We've been searching the area for days now, but all we found was a cave with some grime-faced half-men. No ancient ruin, no treasures, not a damn thing. You know anything about the situation at Varnhold? Varnhold? Never heard of it. Whatever's going on there, we got nothing to do with it. Who's Dugoth? An old cleric. He's seen a lot, he knows a lot, and it seems like he's the only one who has any idea what the hell we're looking for out here. From Numeria, you're pretty far from home. Not so far. The Tiger Lords travel around a lot, from the World Wound to Ioberia. Hell, these lands were once practically home to us. We used to clear them, damn fey, from the Gnarl Marshes on a regular basis. Well, now we're here again. That's the nomad life, you see. Never know where you'll find yourself tomorrow. A demon-haunted wasteland that lies at the northernmost reaches of central Avastan, the world wound is unnatural blight. It is a rift to the abyss open on the material plane. It appeared shortly after the death of the god of Rodin at the beginning of the Age of Lost Omens, and is probably the greatest threat to life on the face of Galarian. East of Brevoy, and considered part of the continent of Kazmaren, the first recorded inhabitants of the era were cyclopes of the kingdom of Koloran, who left giant ruins in Ioberia. Koloran Cyclopes were refugees from an even older realm of Golgon and Garund, and left that kingdom looking for a new life free of brutality and bloodlust that would soon cause its demise. Human settlers have united the land into an empire in the past, but currently the land is largely wilderness, thanks to a series of plagues that have severely depopulated the region. Tell me about your tribe. The Tiger Lords are an ancient and glorious tribe, one of the strongest in all Numeria. We used to own half the stolen lands ourselves, but that was a long time ago, back in the time of Great Armag. But now that the spirit of Armag's been reborn into the body of our new chieftain, you mark me. Word of our heroic deeds will spread across Galarian once again. Tell me about Numeria. Ugh, I hate this question. While Numeria is a hard land made for hard people, ages ago stars rained from the sky and left a bunch of chunks of sky metal across the land, some as small as your finger, others big as a mountain. Lots of the chunks just sit still and do nothing, and we mine them for adamantine. Others make monsters, or diseases, or radiation, and stuff like that. Technicology. Nober spits the last word, almost like a curse. Numeria is also the birthplace of countless beautiful songs and heroic legends. I mean, most of them end with someone getting beheaded, impaled, chopped to pieces, or burned alive, but still, they're marvelous. You don't like technology? Why would I? Bad enough it brings us so much trouble on its own, but it also attracts villains from all over Avastan, like flies to a steaming pile of shit. That Technic League alone, ugh. Are you the only group of Numerians here? You're kidding, of course not. Our main camp's over the hills there. If you're feeling gutsy, come pay us a visit. Safe travels. Just over the hills, a Kellid barbarian pant. What's this? Is there actually stuff here? Coins? Oh, we should have rested there. Let's rest at the Thorn Ford. I think we're gonna need it for these inconsequent debates. Here before. How are we gonna pull this off? Camp camo. Cooking. +3 to all skill checks for the day. That sounds good. Camping is reduced by 1 hour. That sounds good too.
Clashing swords. Hours despairing, vows made in silence, hoping and daring. Ugh, that rhyme is rubbish. I know all the words. Why is it so hard to put them together?
Excellent. We leave just behind a few more things. Do we need 52 pieces of meat? For the wolves. +3 to skill checks, which will probably come in handy in these debates. Here we go. Zerd, Nerd Zottenrappel, a very pale gnome with dull brittle hair, is scribbling something busily on a small scroll. Now looking up as you approach. Ah, here you are, at last. Go read the rules quickly. They're posted a little further along. The other team's already arrived a while ago. The host said we'll start as soon as you show up and read the rules. Of course, I'm famous enough for my admirers to follow my every move, but still I'd like to know. How did you know we were coming? The gnome shrugs. The host said so. Well, are you going to keep wasting time? Read the rules and we'll start. I'd rather fight than demons and talk with the Fae. Sir Alfrey? Can't think of anything but tentacles. Kobold? Jump mice, my friends. Good have friends. Alright, we have to read the rules. Fixing his glasses, Jubilos looks at the paper describing the rules. Well, let's see. I'll read out loud so that everyone can hear. Rules of the inconsequent debates. Year to be added later. I see the authors didn't overstrain themselves. So the rules. Item 1. Obey the host in everything. Item 2. Come in triplets. Item 3. No fighting. No killing each other, even temporarily. Even if you really want to. Even if you apologize later. Item 4. The most important one. The participant must assume the shape of a giant frog. Jubilos looks puzzled. A frog? What does that have to do with anything? Are those the right rules for competition? What irresponsible word monger may... What is this? Am I a frog? Something is obviously wrong here. It's It's not difficult to see that the text of the last item of the rules is a little different from the others. It looks like someone just added it in, vaguely copying the style. The last rule has been added to the others. I would say someone inserted it on purpose and charmed the scroll somehow. That's sabotage! The huge frog can't keep his peace and croaks in indignation. Turning me, into a giant ugly toad. How would you please tell me, am I supposed to participate in the debates like this? I didn't carefully rehearse my image and the impressions I make on my listeners just to lose it all in a snap. And what if this spell can't be lifted? My admirers won't even recognize me. Don't be upset, you're not an ugly frog. In fact, you're a rather handsome one. No, I can't bear this. Are you saying that the last rule was written in? Some other participant must have done it to hinder their rivals. Asirius, we need to find the trickster and make them fix it. Don't worry, I'll question everyone here and identify the trickster. Don't worry about anything. I'll go run to the host and ask him a few questions for my book. It'll buy you some time. You start looking for whoever is responsible for this. It's you, wasn't it? The pale gnome reads aloud enthusiastically. And the young wizard desperately thrashed about in his fetters, but all in vain. The shoots of the plants held him tightly. The nymph, cruel and beautiful, sneered at him and immediately...
And immediately what?
And immediately anything. The left frog is mocking the right one. Does this book ever end? I thought the wizard would die in the last chapter while he's running from the horde of unicorns through fields of giant flytraps. Oh, like you understand anything about literature, you stupid toad. The gnome looks at you. Ah, hello again, travelers. Seems I haven't introduced myself. I'm Nerd Zottenrappel, and these two idiots are my brothers, Vyar and Luar. So what did the nymph immediately do to the wizard? It's too much to tell. She keeps him hostage for another four chapters. I like it when it's more like real life. In this author's last book, he escapes from the evil wizard in 5 minutes. Why are you calling these frogs your brothers? Ha ha ha, these fools read the rules, and the rules are charmed. Nerd's colorless and dim eyes flare up with mad and joyful fire. Anyone who reads them turns into a frog, so now I have two frog brothers. Guess I'll leave them as they are. When else will I have a chance to laugh so much? And why are they both frogs? Did they read them together? Yes, Nerd responds quickly. Nah, the frog on the right says happily. Shut up, Luar. Of course we did. We read them and we transformed. Now we're sitting and croaking. You look pale. She looks bleached. Jubilas's voice is grim. It's all right. I've still got a fair bit of fight left in me. The Zottenrappels don't go down easy, Nerd smiles cunningly. My brothers and I lost our color long ago, but death still hasn't taken us. Are you participating in the debates? Sure, although really we're just here to see the show. We figured it would be fun, and we were right. Never mind, talk to you later. A little kobold raises his little snout at you. Greetings! Are you participating? It's like a spell was cast over my friend when he read the rules. Did anything like that happen to you? I don't read. Gnome, help me. Read for me. Aloud. But then scream. I scared. Why do you have those jerboas there? Kobold lowered his head. Fae say need three. I know three. I know friends. Wanted to go very much. Caught this jump mice. Now we are three. Participate. So what do you want to ask the host if you win? I dragon. How become dragon? So you're participating in the debates too? The kobold brightens. Yes, participate. I participate. Amazing. We'll be completing against the inarticulate king of unforgettable Tartuk. The kobold looks at Jubilas with interest. Huge frog. You speak? Can we mount you? I feed you ants, clean you skin. I am rider. In the list of all the job offers I've ever received, this will be honorably placed in the I'm Ready to Cry section. Alright, I'll go. See you! Did you do this, Sir Alfrey? Greetings, I'm Sir Alfrey, loyal follower of the Tentacles of Iomadae. Also known as the Inheritor, Light of the Sword, and Lady of Valor, is the goddess of righteous valor, justice, and honor. Having served as a rodent's herald, she inherited many of the last Aslanti's followers upon his death. and continues to espouse the ideas of honor and righteousness in the defense of good and the battle against evil. Knight, Noble, and Crusader from Mendev. Tentacles. Oh yes, my knightly motto used to be courteous even in death, but I'm afraid it must now be to severing the tentacles of evil. In just a few phrases, he managed to pour more pomposity on us than I can manage in a week. Quite a talent. The tentacles of evil? And why is it that you just want to change the motto, sir? You see, upon my arrival, I immediately went to read the tentacles of this event, but Guile already had me in its tentacles. The rules were charmed, and everyone who reads them must say tentacles every so often, which is happening to me just now. Tentacles. If I can't get rid of this affliction, at least tentacles. I can make it into my motto. Do you have any idea who could have done this to the rules? It was done by one of the participants who allowed their tentacles to guide their heart, including you and me and my tentacles. 4 teams of 3 arrived. I swear by my tentacles, my service to the most honest Imode would never allow such tentacles, nor would I suspect you and your companions, noble tentacles all. Look for the villain among the other 2 teams. So you're a Mendevian crusader? Truly spoken, I hope you've heard about our glorious tentacles. Our order fights demons fearlessly, preventing their tentacles from spreading across the world. You don't often meet an Asimar in these lands. Asimars are not so uncommon in our tentacles. Celestials are known to aid Mendevian crusaders in our war against the demons. Sometimes this camaraderie sparks a tentacle. I mean, personal attraction. But just the presence of a holy celestial nearby can sometimes cause the birth of an Asimar child. See? Easy as tentacles. Did you try to talk to the host about this? I did, in the name of tentacles. But Fae, they think that cheating within the rules is tentacles and perfectly appropriate. As a true knight, I must overcome these tentacles resolutely. So you're participating in the debates? I most certainly am, by my tentacles. I've come here to carry out the will of my tentacles and send a good example for my tentacles, and possibly to find a new way to fight tentacles, that is, demons. If I win, the Fae might answer all my tentacles. I think I have to go. Before you leave, let me ask you, and in the name of tentacles, don't consider it idle curiosity. What need brought you to the tentacles debates? That would be me. I asked for the Baron's help in this endeavor because winning will let us ask what made the tentacles. Ahem. What caused the gnomes to leave the first world? For me, these tentacles are something more than mere scientific curiosity. I'm amazed at how inquisitive the tentacles of your mind are, sir. I admit it's the first tentacles that I've ever talked to, such a learned frog. Tentacles! Forgive me for my ignorance, but it never even crossed my feeble tentacle that there are educated ones among your race. For the love of Desna, I'm not a frog. Let it be known to you, sir, that you're speaking to Jubilas Narthropel, well-known publicist and researcher. This shape but the consequences are but the consequences of a silly prank. I am a gnome, and that's why I'm participating in the debates, to learn how my race received the affliction called the bleaching and discover a way to fight it. In any case, I wish our worthy rivals good tentacles. In the name of truth, justice, and tentacles. It had to be you. A little kobold said you helped him read the rules. Yeah, that's true, but he wasn't trying to read the frog rules. They're different on every pole. One turns you into a frog, another makes you say tentacles, the third one makes you scream like crazy. Hilarious, right? Not remotely. You're confused, my friend. If one of you read the rules for the kobold, then why isn't one of you screaming? How was it that both of your brothers were turned into frogs? And if Nerid already saw what happened and knew the rules were charmed, then why did she tell us to read them? You suspect us of something. Why would we charm the rules and read them ourselves? Or make you read them and put a spell on you? Nerid adjusts her ridiculous helm and strikes a rakish pose. Because you're gnomes. Only a gnome could think of playing a joke on everyone around and then joyfully get caught in their own prank. You're far-sighted and loud-voiced. I like you. Answer clearly. Did you charm the rules? Why are you picking on us? Our sister is the one who did it. Enough snitching, Luar. You're just jealous that it was Nerid who came up with the idea. And why did you do it? You're so boring. We wanted to, so we did it. Just think how funny it will be. Debates, where all the participants are screaming or talking about tentacles or just croaking. Nerid roars with laughter. But we're honest players, so we charmed ourselves too. We wouldn't want an unfair advantage. Well, I say it's a fine prank. Let everything stay as it is. Amazingly, Jubilas sighs with relief. Ah, there you are. Glad I found you. I stalled for as long as I could, but now it's time to begin. Let's go, quickly. The hooded creature looks mundane, but after looking for a time, one might notice the figure's contours tremble and flow as if in a haze. Welcome to the Inconsequent Debates. You can call us the host, for we are the reason for all that happens here today. You've read the rules, have you not? Not that there's anything useful in them. We only made up the real rules the day after tomorrow, then forgot them and had to make new ones. So it's simple. You want, as your reward, for us to answer a question. So the competition will involve answering questions. We ask, and each one in triplet answers. And always the same one. The others can only prompt. Let's see, it will be you, Little Kobold, you, Sir Alfred, you, Nerd, and you, Asirius. Remember one thing. Here at the Inconsequent Debates, there are no right or wrong answers. Every answer has weight, and each will be weighed. Don't choose the lightest one. Your rival might find a heavier argument. And most importantly, light answers are no fun for us. Why are you referring to yourself in the plural, host? You hear laughter emerge from under the hood. You know very well, you've met us, Asirius, but it was different. It was a different us at a different time. For now, be satisfied that we do not wish to disclose ourselves. Tell us, why do you creatures from the first world need to organize all this? Win the competition and ask. Those are the rules of the game, right? Hell no, we are not wasting a precious question to discover the motives of the Fae and their lords. I don't have the imagination to think how absurd and silly their answer might be. Let's begin. Begins! The kobold jumps for joy. We are ready, the knight nods resolutely, despite the tentacles. Alright, let's see how tough they have it in the first world. Some of you look so serious, thus we'll begin with a question about weighty matters. What can move a mountain? Jubilas, Lindsay, what's our answer? Oh, I shouldn't have skipped my philosophy lessons at the academy. Such problems baffle me. It's not because I can't think of an answer, but because I can think of 1,000 of them at once, and don't know where I can hide from them. Let's see. We're dealing with Fae in the first world, and they told us clearly that trivial answers won't cut it. I think the good answer is its own will. In the first world, mountains often change position, and there's at least one that does it of its own free will. That's Ulas, one of the Tain, the Walking Mountain. Its own will. We heard you. What would the others say? What can move a mountain? Little Kobold frowns desperately. Maybe dragon? Dragon can move mountain. Faith and divine intervention. Do you hear my faithful tentacles? Faith nourishes us. With devout faith in our tentacles and a righteous cause, everything is within our tentacles. A teleportation spell. Ha ha ha. I could probably manage moving a hill or two. In fact, that gives me an idea. We have heard you, now you hear us. Of course gods and magic can move mountains. That answer is good for any question. How can one jump over the house? Magic. How to paint a face yellow using blue paint? Divine intervention. Such light answers are the weakest. A good answer is its own will. Will and desire lie at the base of all our motions, action, and decision. If a mountain has a will, it will surely find a way to move. That was an interesting round. Let the next question be heard. What weakens when owned by many, and dies if owned by none? Jubilast? What? I'm sorry, I got distracted. These mosquitoes are so delicious. The frog stops for a moment and then starts to curse. Daemons, take those mosquitoes. I'll go mad in this shape. So the answer, I think it's glory. Can't belong to many, otherwise the value of each is diminished. Glory. The little kobold looks as if about to cry. I don't know this. Maybe it's dragon? It's the knight's heart. I swear by my tentacles. It can belong to himself or this righteous cause, or to his greatest tentacles. It can't belong to everybody. Vyar, look how I can roll my eyes. Fools, concentrate on the competition. This won't do. We won't accept this answer from the Zotan rabble triplet this round, but you are a spectacular eye roller. Now, as for the other answers, the heart is not the best answer. Even among knights, there are many whose hearts belong to a beautiful woman and a beloved mother, plus their friends, their commander, their righteous cause, and a delicious lunch. Especially a delicious lunch. And it doesn't seem that those hearts that belong to many grow any weaker. Glory is a poor answer. Only an extremely egoistic person who does not wish to share credit could think that it couldn't belong to many. One's own glory does not diminish anyone else's. We are almost prepared to agree on the dragon, but alas, no one gains victory in this round. Here the third question. Each of us is born at the same time with a monster. Each day we live, it grows. It can torment, bring us joy, or kill without a single wound. What is it? What do you say, Jubilost? Considering the question is asked by a representative of the Fae, the answer could be anything from singing to the love of pastries. But let's think logically. The last part of the riddle can be easily ignored, because just about everything in the world can aid or ruin you depending on the circumstances. What's important is that the riddle clearly points to some quality of property of a living creature, something that is born with us. Another point, it grows. I would say knowledge. Each new day brings something new, so our knowledge of ourselves and the world keeps growing. For some, though, this process is ridiculously slow. So I thought ambition, but it's knowledge. We have heard you. What would the others say? What is the monster? The little kobold grabs his head, stressed. Maybe it's a dragon? It's curiosity. It's born with us. It grows day by day. It saves us from the bleaching. If you only knew how many it killed. I don't know if this answer will do, but the greatest tentacles is the one that lives inside us. We grow a tentacles beast in our soul. We feed it with wrath, neglect, and tentacles. Eventually, it could break free and kill us, but tentacles must admit, the same beast gives strength to villains and tentacles. The poison we feed our monsters only nourishes them. Interesting answers, except for the dragon. The dragon doesn't count, alas. Curiosity is also insufficient. The monster we describe must by its own nature grow. Many see their curiosity dim over the years. We like the answers about knowledge and the inner beast, but both seem somewhat light. We expected something more substantial. We declare that both Sir Alfrey and Assyrius, along with the triplets, shall share the victory for this round. But remember, a victory shared by two is half the victory. One final trial and we will sum up the results. I grow tired of questions. Do you know the game Knight Dragon Snag? The knight defeats the dragon burns the snag, but if the knight walks in the woods, he'll stumble on the snag and die. That is why snag defeats the knight. Children's games, great. These are the inconsequent debates. Why not play a game? So you break up into pairs and yell out your chosen word at the signal. The one who shouts knight defeats the one who shouts dragon. The one who shouts dragon defeats the one who shouts snag, and snag defeats knight. We'll play Sir Alfrey against the kobold, and Nerd Zottenrabel against the baron. The winners will then play each other. Is the first pair ready? Yell on three. One, two, three. Knight. Dragon! This was all too predictable, but charming in a way. The host is obviously enjoying the game. It's a good thing we didn't look ahead. It's much more fun to see it unfold like this. Sir Alfrey wins. Now for the second pair. Are you ready? One, two, three. Snag. Dragon! Nerd shouts, performing a spot-on impersonation of the kobold, then falls over laughing. Looks like her own amusement is more important to her than the competition. Nerd Zottenrabel wins this round. Don't sigh so mournfully, Sir Jubilos. Your disappointment will make all the flowers within 100 steps wilt and die. Besides, all is not lost. The results have yet to be tallied. The final pair, Nerd against Sir Alfrey. One, two, three. Sir Alfrey takes a deep breath with his mighty chest, but then the curse takes over. Tentacles! Drat! Nerd begins, but then she hears what her opponent has shouted, refuses to finish, and doubles over with laughter. No one wins this round. Well, it was fun anyway. Now it's time to announce the winner of the debates. After four tests, the triplet of the Baron and Sir Jubilos wins. It was most amusing, children, most amusing. You should know that this is rare praise from us. Congratulations, sirs and ladies. I swear by my tentacles it was a worthy struggle. Baron, as the voice of your triplet, you may ask us the one question promised and another question besides that, as an extra reward for the ingenuity or luck you demonstrated in the competition. Assyrius, do you remember the fate of the gnome? Jubilos suddenly stops talking. He opens and closes his mouth, but makes not a sound. Have a silence spell, mate. Ha ha ha, I love it. Now what's he going to do? Come, brothers, let's run. Now everything is in your hands, Asirius. Think well upon your questions. We will answer honestly, but I don't know is also an honest answer. Ask about what a host from the first world might know. I want to know why the gnomes left the first world. There is the question. We knew it would be asked, but a simple answer, a light answer, has no value, right? We hope our debates convinced you of this. This is why we present you another answer, a good one, a valuable one. Numbers will help you on your way. One of them is 5th and 10th, and it will be easy to find if you read who opened the road for the ancient dead man. And his black-feathered message, the second is a dozen times in a dozen, and is thrice the number of those who lost their faces. Don't try to guess it now, it's not yet time. Wait until he who was born twice will twice be defeated. Put the two numbers together. When the moon leaves her path near the waters of the Candlemere, find the one who will open the secret. A heap of senseless mumble instead of a... First walk the road, then you may accuse us of being senseless, but in the end you won't. I want to know why you organized all this, host. I'm leaning towards. I want to know why you organized all this, host. We were bored. That's the fey for you. Try living multiple eternities like us. Your views on entertainment might change radically. That was your final question. We have the answer and yet we don't. But what an adventure. Asirius, we'll have to discuss this further on our return to the capital. Farewell, Asirius. Ah, we almost forgot. The host turns to the kobold. You, little creature. You didn't win, but you managed to make us laugh. Do you want to come with us? No promises you'll turn into a dragon, but still. The kobold jumps from joy, but then carefully asks, pointing at his jerboas. Take my friends, yes? All right, fine, the hooded creature laughs. Listen all, the inconsequent debates are now closed. We spare all of you the effects of the Zottenrabble tricks, and bid you farewell. Yay. We won the debates. Lost. Fae are no match for my ingenuity. The debates, the Fae, and their mysteries, and most importantly, we don't have to fight anyone. I like this adventure. Me too, young Lindsay, by my tentacles. Did the Fae hide anything here? Perception? Kobold with him. We were bored. I should have asked about gaining power and immortality. That would have been a better question. If you can become, that'd be cool if you could become like a fae, powerful and immortal. Alright. And with that,
head to Wooddale. I don't remember if I've been in here and saw any crafters. Pelts. All right, back to the capital we go. Dragon. Kobold and his little friends get to go to in the first world. Guess we'll head back. Oh, where's the Kellogg camp? Kellogg Barbarian camp. It's just over the hill. It's way over there. Should have grabbed some of these things. Oh. Someone bring me a gift, like a gift. Alright, so I'm gonna be right back and then I'll handle some matters of state. Maybe advance a few days. Then head back and maybe check out that Kellogg Barbarian camp. Let's see what's going on. Oh, here comes someone. Draugen bows from the waist, addresses you ceremoniously. Full plate. I need something from you. How about a one-handed axe? Let's try that. Well, dude, we have enough to split open us. For that. Sweet. Full plate. Oh, dragon scale plate. Grants us wear acid resistance 30. Dragon scales faded and cracked of age, but the armor looks solid. Valerie can certainly wear it, right? Yes, it's an 11. Pretty cool. And then Harem can probably put on the banded mail. Awesome, so I'll be right back. Alright, and I'm back, so let's check out some matters of state here. So we've got trade agreements brewing. Curse, rank up. Eleven days. I don't know if I should use this time to rank somebody up. Maybe cure. Alright, so we'll just skip a day here and end that. Morhalan's current location has been discovered. Alright. So now what? Do I go there and deal with him myself? Selling that. What's Mary wearing? So that's okay, I'll just buy some more. Falchion plus one. Persecutor, I should have hang on to. Plus two. Dueling sword. Some of the stuff I might have held on to. Yes, that's good. Somewhere on the map. If so, where? soldier's hideout. Secret Poacher's Camp. Shirelle the Tailor suspects this band of hunting lizard folk for their skins. Poacher Alchemist. Morlan looks at you apprehensively, his voice sounds confident. Greetings, Your Grace. I can see that my humble efforts to escape your observant royal gaze have seemed to have miserably failed. Well, that'll be all right. It remains for me to make you an offer that you will find hard to resist. What are you suggesting? The very same thing that I offer all the other over-meticulous hunters and prying guards. Gold. Gold, Your Grace. All that I've managed to save and scrape up over my life. Rest assured, it's a very substantial amount. You wouldn't reject an offer like this just because some naive spring chicken decided they want to play justice. What a disgusting offer. You'll be brought to justice. Help me, lads. Stop, you win. The jail is better than the grave. So he went to jail then. That hurt good. Well, it's pretty simple. From Shirelle. Bring me some armor or something. The end times are nigh. Size harem. Anything? Nothing. Still serene, only got 200 BP to work with. Brings in up to 2 BP, times of unrest. Time to waste. To figure out what happened to Varnhold and Fast. I'm gonna head back to the Dunsward area, do some adventuring. Let's see if I can find some more insane wizards to slay. Bad you can't take horses out though. Cut down your traveling time a bit, that'd be cool. It would just, you know, take some hours off the clock when you're traveling to different areas. Wonder why that's not in the game. Screens. Overgrown cavern. Have we been there?
I need to catch my breath.
Everybody's tired and exhausted.
More strength fades.
Rested Varnhold. Octavia's not too exhausted that she can walk in the camp.
More strength fades.
Right here. Back in the snow again. Let's get fish on the set deck. Armor.
Listen, Harem, this Brodus of yours, what's he like? Some disgusting slimy monster sitting in a cave, waiting for all of us to die, writhing around like a snake.
It's the opposite, Amiri. Grotus is the beautiful moon shining over Pharasmus Boneyard. Well, not what is normally called beautiful. He does look like a skull.
Oh, it was cooking bugged out? Did we get the... No, cooking bugged out. Maybe we cannot cook there. Maybe I didn't see that. It's an area we couldn't cook in. Cave is partly destroyed and can barely be seen through the heavy vegetation. First of the rare freedom. Say what you will, I live free. It doesn't mean you won't get beaten up for what you say, though. That's right. I like that freedom. Freedom of speech. Hello? Hey, who's that walking over there? Barbarian standing guard at the cave entrance calls over to you coarsely. It's dangerous to walk around here. Better turn back. Amiri answers something in Halit, the native tongue of the Numerian Kelid tribes. After a brief exchange in Halit with Amiri, the guard switches back to common. Peace. If you want to speak with our elders or spend the night, you may enter. Just don't expect a free dinner. You again, what do you need? Guard looks at you with their hands on their weapons. I'm just a traveler looking for a safe place to spend the night. Please let me in. Traveler, alright, come in. Warm yourself by the fire. Just stay out of storage and don't expect a free meal. You. What are they doing? Why do I keep getting this?
Here.
What is going on? All six characters had to do that, I guess. I'll take that. Let's put that lantern back on Valerie's belt. Oh, it is there. I like edible moss. He's Crostata. Guess I could take all that stuff. Olga. Half-orc woman sits by the fire. Her clothes are made up of leather and fur, matching the rest of the barbarian. She frowns as she slides her finger along a map, crudely drawn on a crumpled sheet of paper. She lifts her gaze as she notices you. Huh, guests. Who are you? If you're a friend, take a seat by the fire and let's talk. I'm Bolga from the Tiger Lord's tribe. I lead this group. When Bolga's gaze stops on Knock Knock, she chuckles. Quite a beast you got there. Ones like that we use for rags back home. Their hearts aren't good enough for anything else. Ones like you I use for chowder. Meat like dung, not good for anything, not good for nothing else. Knock Knock glares at the sturdy woman with a predatory look as he runs a finger along the edge of his blade. Are you a chieftain? Me? No. Just seasoned enough to lead a group. Our chieftain is Armag the Twiceborn. Bolga says the name proudly as though expecting recognition or awe. He's back home in Numeria right now. What's your chieftain known for? Long ago, he was the greatest of the Numerian chieftains, and Gorm's chosen. Armag was so strong, no mortal could strike him down. It was only when Phrasma herself challenged him to battle that he fell, and only because of her divine power. But now Armag shamed her and came back from the afterlife. Great Armag leads the Tiger Lords once more, but now as Armag the Twiceborn, and soon word of our exploits will spread all over Avastan. I didn't know there were half-orcs among the Numerian barbarians. Barbarian shrugs. The orcs have lands nearby. A lot can happen between two neighboring peoples. What are you doing here? We're looking for some ruins or a cave or something. I don't really know. Only Dugoth knows exactly what we're looking for. He's a cleric and he's our leader on this expedition. Well, him and the sisters. Where might I find Dugoth and these sisters? They're in our main camp, here, Bolga points at a cross on our map. If you're looking to hire us or have some other business, come visit. It'd be much better than digging around in the dirt out here. Who are these sisters? They're witches who serve Armag. They seem to know a lot about the world, history, gods, even other worlds. They're pretty smart talkers. You'd hardly believe the things they know. They have these strange, unimaginable spells. When Armag ordered us to pack up for this expedition, we thought we'd be marching for a month. But they just waved their hands. Whoosh! A tunnel of multicolored lights opened before us. The trip here took us just 1 hour. Can you imagine it? I wouldn't be surprised if you can't. Have you found anything of interest? It'd be nice if we had. So far it's just dirt, crap, and monsters. Like we don't get enough of that back in Numeria. We found this hole and the monsters that were living here. We took a beating doing it, but we managed to kick them out. Then after we searched the place, we found out it's just a regular cave. Nothing of note. After a day or so, we'll probably head out and keep searching. So this is where the Spriggans lived, and they were booted out of here. That's why they were hostile to us. You know anything about the situation at Varnhold? Varnhold, where's that? The barbarian looks down at her map and finds a rough sketch of the area. No idea. We've never been there. Tell me about Numeria. Numeria is the land with adamantine in its soil, and its people have adamantine in their hearts. The barbarian starts solemnly, then her tone shifts. And since we have bugger all beyond adamantine and courage, we just trade what we've got. She laughs. I have to go. Sure, no point in denting our asses in this hole. We'll soon head out. Soon. We'll head out soon, most like. Safe journey to you. Nice meeting you, Bolga.
I'll go ahead.
Just poke around this previous Spriggan cave and gather our mushrooms.
The path is clear.
Ooh, bracers. A bunch of stuff. And a bunch more stuff. These braces of armor. Plus 4, always nice, worth 4,000. Alright, see you guys later. Hopefully no more diplomacy checks. Oh no. Looks like I came to the wrong place. Well, free XP.
Tread lightly.
That is a strange bug. Let's report it. Hey, what are you doing here? I guess he had to ask all 6 people. So we can go check out the barbarian camp. On the way there, though, let's dig in the dirt and mud. Sepulcher just yet. Ruined tower. It's a decayed tower that looms over the plains. This ancient setting has withstood both the elements and the test of time. Decayed but unyielding, the tall structure remains. Half-destroyed staircase with unusually tall steps lead to the higher floors. The tower walls are covered with eroded inscriptions and images. Sounds fun. The ground in this mysterious place has been heavily disturbed, marked with numerous strange furrows, scarring the grass and unusual sunken depressions and raised mounds across the area. Sounds fun too. Excuse me. Check out the blood furrows. Looks like the horse fell while trying to climb the rock. It must have been terrified to attempt such a thing. Deep furrows mar the grass in this area as if a huge plow had been put to work here. This horse died from Horse died from a neatly slit throat, probably made with a sharp blade, but its body is also covered with deep wounds that resemble huge bite marks. That combined with the furrows on the ground leads you to one conclusion. You've entered a Buletti's hunting grounds. The underground monster must still be somewhere nearby. Barbarian seems to have died from massive blood loss. Horrible wounds cover his body, though his hand is still clenching a knife. Of stuff. The inscription on the stone is made with blood. The text says, "Running is no help, the grass betrays. Stay with me, better die than become food for." Word? Oh.
I'm not afraid.
I am. Ancient Buletti.
Tear them apart!
I'm leaking red all over myself.
Oh, we got it.
Done.
There's a deep hole in the ground made recently. At the bottom you can see a pile of bloody rags that looks like the remains of some of a barbarian's clothes. 960 XP for that. Well, that was simple enough. A boulette. Let's learn what boulettes are. It's a strange one. The creation of some unknown arcanist a millennia past, the boulette has bred true to become one of the fiercest predators of the hills, burrowing rapidly through the earth just beneath the surface, sometimes with its armored fin cutting a distinctive wake behind it. The boulette launches itself free of stone and soil to tear into prey without remorse, giving rise to the common appellation landshark. Boulettes are notoriously foul-tempered, attacking far larger creatures with no regard for personal safety. Solitary beasts, except for the occasional mated pair, they spend most of their time patrolling the perimeters of territories that can stretch up to 30 square miles, hunting game and punishing interlopers with a fury that shakes the hillsides. Boulettes are perfect eating machines, consuming bones, armor, even magical items with their powerful jaws and churning stomach acid. Lacking other food, the boulette might gnaw on inanimate objects, yet for unknown reasons, no boulette voluntarily consumes elf flesh. A peccadillo many point to as evidence that elven wizardry was involved in its creation. Dwarves are also rarely eaten by the beast, though the boulette still slaughters members of either race on sight. Halflings, on the other hand, are among the beast's favorite meals, and no halfling with any sense ventures into boulette country casually. The boulette is a cunning fighter, surprising foes with its impressive agility. One of its favorite tactics is to charge forward and launch itself into the air in order to drop on its prey with all four razor-sharp claws extended. Folklore claims the flesh behind the beast's dorsal crest is particularly tender, and those willing and able to wait until the fin is raised in the excitement of combat or mating can target it for a killing blow. Yet most who have faced the land shark agree that the best way to win a fight with a boulette is to avoid it entirely. Or do what we just did. Chop it up and make boulette stew. Let me read this cheese recipe. I did take a recipe. Cheese crostata. Excuse me. Check out this ruined tower. The ruins of the tower loomed over the surrounding plains, like a tombstone so old that time had worn away the epitaph, as well as the language it had been written in. Each crumbling step of the giant stairway was tall as a grown man's chest, and the huge portal to where the door once stood was wide enough for our entire party to walk abreast through. We decided to climb the tower? Amiri, maybe? Come on. Succeeded. It was hard to imagine how tall the building must have been before crumbling under its own weight. It's possible that even the owners would have towered above us had they still been around. Even so, by using the cracks and pits in the stone wall, an experienced climber would be likely to scale the tower. Amiri spat on her hands and swiftly climbed up to one of the high ledges, what remained of the second floor. There the walls had deteriorated even further. They were covered with engravings, barely visible symbols of some ancient language. After catching her breath, she decided to climb further? Succeeded. Climbing higher was no easy task. Amiri's fingers slipped on wet moss and the rocks crumbled beneath her feet. Perched atop a shelf on the opposite wall, a large black raven watched Amiri's ascent intently. Clinging to the signs that were carved into the wall, Amiri slowly began moving upwards. At last, she reached the top. An uneven stub was all that was left of the spire that once must have reached to the lower clouds. Alas, there was no treasure to be found here unless you're willing to count the magnificent view of the surrounding area. A fire flickered in the distance. Someone had set up camp there. Finding out she had seen enough, Amiri carefully descended. After that, we decided to leave. We walked away, leaving the stone colossus to its eternal slumber. This area. Well, we should fight. Let's see what Dunsward has to offer. Watch it be like 3 boulettes.
More strength fades.
Goblins.
I
hope it's not fight back. Best kind of fight.
Tear them apart.
Silly goblins. It's frost here. Probably hut in the area. Don't think it'll hurt.
Born in a noble family. Servants to lick my boots and bring me breakfast in bed. Not like in my tribe. They wake you up with a kick and hustle you to cook for them. The stinking goats.
I bet your time among nobility would be even shorter than mine. You'd jump up the moment you were trying on your third dress or drinking tea with your auntie. You'd trash the place and run into the forest.
Hunting only took 5 hours, it's nice. Good to go. Those must have been some pretty confident goblins. They wanted that mastodon meat. Be cool if you can outfit your pets with trinkets and gear and stuff. Spider Lair, peculiar place on the outskirts of Dunsward, inhabited by giant spiders, dangerous monsters the size of a pony. Locals avoid this place even when in search of lost livestock. The cow or sheep goes missing and the owner suspects the animal wandered in here. They give it up as a lost cause. If the animal is probably caught in a spider's trap, if not already killed and eaten. Let's go. Yeah, Yes, I want to enter this place. Are you kidding me? Hope there's some plus 5 sickle hidden here. Someone was killed but not eaten.
Who will
come get some?
Does it matter?
Let us strike as one!
Best kind of fight.
Boom. Running through primal spiders. I want a normal Eastark. Trout's good though. Oh, hello.
Do not talk that. Knock more runner and talker than fighter. That one went deep.
I have a Sirius up there. Come on, just kill it quickly. What is the problem? Get there, Amiri. We're not even at a lair yet.
The end draws near.
Magnificium Turinos. Magnificium Turinos. Magnificium Turinos.
That's good enough.
Magnificium Turinos.
Can we enter this lair? No.
Will we not talk first?
Oh, he took attacks of opportunity. To get him combat mobility, I think. Is that all these spiders got?
I'll go ahead.
And then get some. In my knock knock.
A solid plan.
Oh, the matriarch. Here, I tried to bite it. This thing's pretty tough. Take your legs. And a box. With food in it. Baked spider legs recipe. Someone came here trying to make some food. Buckler, 900 gold coins. Arrow guard, +4 buckler against grants wield and disher, +3 against range attacks. Nice. Sweet little buckler. But if I want to grow claws, obviously I can't have a buckler in that hand.
The path is clear.
rituals. Cool. Got an extra 2 AC. And a recipe. Start using our spider legs. Render past burial ground? How do I get there? City of Hollow Eyes, do you want to end at this location? No. How do I get there? Our breath at the Kalan Barbarian camp, fortified camp surrounded by a trench and a stockade. The sound of its inhabitants can be heard from outside, voices raised in arguments and laughter, the clanking of swords and the sizzling of meat. Grounds among the hills, some Numerian barbarians have set up camp. While obviously set up recently as a place to rest, it was thoroughly constructed. Along the stake palisade, the Numerians had reinforced their camp with a deep moat. Spotting the body of some unlucky thief at the bottom, it seemed they made a good call. Guarding the entrance was our old acquaintance, Nober, the man whose group we met in the hills previously. While his greeting was none too friendly, he did invite us to enter and led us to meet his leader. We were led to a man named Dugoth, a middle-aged Kellid with a gorgeous mane, once charcoal black, now salt and pepper, as well as bronze skin, hardened by the sun, wind, and time to the point that it almost looked like oak bark. Speaking with assertive tones, he invited us to dine with the Tiger Lords, that was the name of their tribe, spend the night in their camp. Any business we might have with the tribe, he said, could be discussed in the morning once everyone was rested and refreshed. Not wanting to offend the barbarians, we'd proven to be commendably hospitable, we accepted the invitation. Within minutes, we were seated by the bonfire with goblets in our hands. As guests, our goblets were wrought of skillfully decorated silver with intricate carvings depicting scenes of battle. "Do as I do," Amiri whispered into the Baron's ear. "They really care about tradition here." The cupbearer filled everyone's goblets with wine. When Dugoth raised his cup, officially starting the feast, the Baron placed his faith in Amiri and followed her example. To my utter surprise, the barbarian friend spilled her wine on the ground and the Baron followed her example. I thought the Numerians would be enraged, but they all followed suit. It was apparently a barbarian tradition, offering the first cup to the spirits. Only after the cup builder filled their goblets again did the Numerians start to drink, and so did we. The main course, unsurprisingly, was meat. While hunting in the hills, the Numerians had killed a deer and two wild boars, all now roasting over an open fire. As the tribe's guests, we were offered the best pieces. Fierce in battle, the Numerians were equally fierce at the table. They frantically tore the meat apart with knives, bare hands, and teeth, as though attacking the throats of their worst enemies rather than eating roast venison. Only one inhabitant didn't join the dinner. Far from the festivities, a slim woman wrapped in a gray cloak sat alone, her face hidden behind a piece of cloth. She was so quiet and still, at first I didn't realize she was a living being at all. The Baron. either didn't notice her or decided it would be wiser to ignore her. After everyone had eaten their fill, it was time for entertainment. The barbarians began singing a drawling song in their guttural language known as Halit. Later, one of the Numerians explained that it was a ballad about a brother and sister who defeated a huge metal spider. The song that followed was a comedic piece about the adventures of a stupid werewolf. The Numerians all sang it together. It was clear each of them knew that one by heart. Almost everybody clapped to the rhythm, though some thumped their knife handles on their shields, and our half-orc acquaintance Bolga accompanied the song on a vargan. Once the song was over, Dugoth appealed to his guests, us, to surprise our host. The Baron decided our best choice would be... the tale of how we defeated the Stag Lord. Our tale of battle of heroic deeds was just what the barbarians were looking for. They listened eagerly, chimed in on each dale, and laughed and clapped at the most epic moments. Even Dugoth himself found himself smiling and nodding as he listened to our story. Finally, the drinking and singing came to an end. Only bones remained from the feast, and the bonfire had burned down to ash. Satisfied, the Numerians returned to their tents. I think that went pretty well.
I beg you, I haven't seen my sisters for several days. I'm afraid they may be in trouble.
As you approach the barbarian leader, you can't help but overhear part of his conversation with the woman you recognized from the feast before. Her face remains hidden and she sounds extremely worried.
This whole land is nothing but trouble. You want me to risk my life and the lives of my people to do your dirty work? Go ahead, ask Armagh to give the order. Oh, but Armagh stayed back in Numeria, which means I am the one making the decisions here.
The cleric shakes his head.
But what about my sisters? Something terrible could happen to them.
You sisters insisted on this expedition. So it's your price to pay. With your blood, not ours. Something terrible could happen, you say? It is too late for that. We already lost good men on this pointless journey to nowhere. Whatever Armagh needs, it's not here, and it wasn't here from the start. But you didn't come here for him, did you? You came for your own reasons.
Great voice acting. You want
some magic toy that once belonged to the ancient Cyclops. Well, I'm not leading my men to their deaths for that.
Great voice acting.
Dugoth.
This conversation is over. You want help? Why not ask our guests to help you? If you can afford their rates, that is. As for me, my single remaining goal is to get my people home alive and well and as soon as possible.
The woman leaves sobbing. Dugoth turns to you. Good morning. Well, let's get down to business, shall we? Introductions aren't necessary, Baron. I know who you are. Let's discuss how we can be useful to one another. Do you know anything about what happened in Varnhold?
Varnhold, huh? Isn't that the village Megor Varn got from the Rostovic Sword Lords? I know Varn. He's not the best fighter, but not the worst. As for what happened there, I wouldn't know.
Who's that woman?
Wish I knew who these witches are and where they came from. Our chieftain, the great Armagh, spirits bless him, trusts them as if they were holy oracles. He sent us with them to these dead hills, and none but the sisters and the chieftain himself know why. Who am I to confront the chieftain? So now we wander these lands, chasing the unknown.
What are you looking for here?
I wish I knew. The sisters are looking for something, but they won't tell anyone what it is. I guess it's some antique that used to belong to the Cyclops. Some magic trinket or something. As for me, the only thing I'm looking for is a good reason to quit this nonsense and return to Numeria as soon as possible.
Is this how you serve your liege?
Don't confuse our chieftains with your king's knight. It's the chieftain who swears an oath to the tribe, not the other way around. Please. I was one of the tribe's elders when he was in his first teeth.
There's a whole army of you here. How did you get so far?
None of your business, actually. But just to reassure you, we weren't sneaking into your lands without permission, I'll answer. It was magic. The sisters opened some strange tunnel, and we used it to get here from Numeria. Gorum witnessed my words. I'm no coward, but I'd rather march for a month through all the river kingdoms than use that damned tunnel again. It was strange. Wrong. Just like those witches themselves.
How did it go? Did you find anything of interest?
If we did, do you think we'd still be here now? The only thing to be found in these hills is one's own death. A group of my men entered a cave that turned out to be a Spriggan den. They barely survived the encounter. Also, we found the ruins of some old tower, ancient as the world itself, and useless as this expedition. There is nothing to be found here, except, like I said, for one's own death.
Do you know me? How?
How do you think? We keep an eye on everything that happens in the region. It's smart to know our potential employers and our potential enemies. Hard to miss someone like you, dragging this green beast around like another compatriot.
These long shanks know knock-knock already. That is good. Fame is rising already. Just a tad more, and knock-knock will be a real hero.
So how can we be useful to each other?
I'm afraid we can't. At least not yet. I'd be happy to take a new job, but our chieftain's orders were strict. Search the location and come back with a report. But if you could help us here, say, by finding whatever these witch sisters are looking for, or maybe just making them disappear forever. Mark my word, Baron. The Tiger Lords never forget those who helped them.
Let me ask you a question.
Ask away, why not? I don't promise I'll answer, though.
Tell me about yourself.
I'm Dugat, son of Gordir and Harith Threefingers from the Tiger Lords tribe. My entire life, I've served Gorum, first on the battlefield, sword in my hand, and later with prayer as well. I've fought in battles all across the River Kingdoms, in Yoberia, Gold, Ustalev. My price is high, my hand is steady, and my sword is deadly.
Finishing the speech, the man gives you a wide grin, showing off several missing teeth. Tell me about your tribe.
There are many tribes in Numeria. Each does its best to survive. The Black Horses sell adamantine. The Blood Pikes rob caravans, and their white scars lick the boots of the Technic League. As for us, the Tiger Lords, we are mercenaries and the best ones in this part of Avistan. Remember this, Baron. If you keep your throne long enough, we'll meet again, sooner or later, fighting side by side, or otherwise. Who knows?
And some deal in slave trade.
Octavia quietly mutters.
Yes, there's plenty of those too. And their numbers will never dwindle so long as the Technic League runs the country.
What do you know about Cyclopes?
Not that much. Long ago, these lands were part of their empire. They were a great people back then, used unbelievable magic, and possessed treasures beyond count. Ages passed, and their empire crumbled into dust. Cyclops became wild and forgot all about what they once used to be. But the ruins, yes, the ruins remember everything.
Tell me about your chieftain.
He's a strong fighter, brave one. He says he's Armagh, an incarnation of a hero from the old times. Just don't ask if I believe it. Armagh is smart. He knows how to do business. If he'd only pay less attention to what those witches whisper, he'd be a perfect chieftain.
Tell me about Numeria.
Eons ago, stars rained down on Numeria. Pieces of metal, both dead and living ones, fell from the sky. Since then, metal monsters roam those lands, and the grounds hold a wealth of adamantine, among other valuable things. Weaklings don't survive there. As for us, Numerian Kelits, we grew up on that land. We drank its poisoned waters and breathed its toxic air. Metals from the depths infused our bones and muscles. No one can beat us. If there were anyone capable of bringing us down, it would be ourselves.
Tell me about Gorm.
Our Lord in Iron doesn't like empty talk. He's the god of those who act instead of chatter. His palm blesses every sword ever crafted, and wherever at least two men meet in battle, he is there with them. Even orcs worship the god of battle, and not only that, they imagine he's an orc too. It's all nonsense, of course, but there may be a grain of truth to it. For anyone can aspire to be like him, a human, an orc, and even an elf. Anyone who grips his iron to make his enemy bleed.
Well said, old man. Truly well said. Blood for Gorum!
Mary grins approvingly and raises her clenched fist. Harem opens his mouth, obviously wanting to say something, but just sighs and waves his hand instead. Thank you for the answers.
You're welcome.
I have to go.
You have so many scars. You must have seen so much.
Octavia studies Dugoth's muscular body with admiration.
Ah, more than a few, yes. I just gave away my oldest granddaughter to be married. She's a little younger than you.
The barbarian's face remains nonchalant.
So you have vast experience, and not just on the battlefield?
Octavia casts a quick glance at your face. Raise an eyebrow silently.
We have a saying. If you want to live long, don't stand between a mother bear and her children, between a giant and his lunch, or between two lovers. Oh, listen, girl. I'm too old to fall for such tricks. If you want to tease your lover, good luck, but you'll have to find someone younger than me.
Dugoth turns away.
Fine! Go then!
Octavia follows the barbarians with her eyes, vexed, and looks at you. She eyes you like a naughty puppy, and for a moment you feel she's about to apologize, but instead, pouts. So what was that? Why are you teasing me?
Tease you? It was nothing like that. I'm just... well, it doesn't matter. Forget it.
Thank you. there's the Raven. Talk to it. The Raven watches you attentively. So the merchant, Olga. Maybe a lot of ruins here, but they were probably looted centuries ago.
The path is clear.
Doug. An elderly barbarian waves his hand, inviting you to come closer.
Welcome, honored guests. Would you like to buy or sell anything?
Who are you?
Name's Doug. Was hell of a fighter when I was younger. But truth, those years passed before you know it. The health, too.
Barbarian raises his hand, and you can see he only has two fingers left.
So now my job is equipment and provisions, along with a bit of trading from time to time.
Show me your wares. Camping supplies. A recipe, which we'll buy. And learn, and I'll say thank you for joining me for this episode. I think this is what, 54? In the next one, we'll talk to the defaced sister, try to find her other sister she was pouting about or crying about. And yeah, thanks for watching, appreciate the viewership.
Need to catch my breath.
And we'll see you in the next episode. Until then, take care everybody, so long.